Yes, what a show we've got today. We've got the bald couple, sorry, that's the odd couple of Scottish football. How are we doing, lads? It doesn't get any better than that, man.
I won't hold did that first joke take you tonight with that. Oh, man.
I'm so nervous, Dave.
And you actually made a complete cunt of it as well, aye.
Oh, I'm so nervous doing used to, by the way. Usually that sort of
why?
Matter goes down.
Why are you nervous?
It's the first people that I've done that have actually got a couple of brain cells between them.
Oh, that's true.
And your own right for the start, than rather than just coming off the bench for the last 10 minutes, aye.
Yeah.
What I want to say to you as well, Hugh McDonald, your good pal. Told us that you're two of the cleverest men he's ever met.
He's a genius. He's actually a visionary.
He's a great judge of character.
Yeah, what he'll do to get in our second show for another quid.
I think he must mean there are different layers of cleverness. Certainly mine would not be academically. I get more grades in my hires, but Stuart full knows. Pulled out of Napier College by, it was a phrase that all the footballers use now.
Yeah.
Mutual consent. When I wasn't really paying attention to my studies, and so because of that, I wasn't much used to them. They were getting fed up, wondering where I was for lectures and everything. So that was it. So I left the college by mutual consent, rather. Unlike Stuart, who's been at how many houses of education?
I think I've probably got about 6, maybe 7 degrees, Tam, something like that. Yeah, PhDs and all that guff. I'm getting another one next summer in Hull, where I went to university, so they've asked me to come for an honorary fellowship.
And I'll get 2 old grades, woodwork and arithmetic. The only job I could get after school was making rulers. Right, see, that's a joke. Try ones like that.
See, outside off the ball, what sort of stuff do you speak about? Is it football, or is it much more
BBC contracts stuff? Is the main one just now.
Well, you know what? The lack of them. Stuart will back me up in this way. Our chat, Outworth off the ball, basically involves when we're having a cup of coffee in a Saturday morning before we start talking about the show, because we'll have that wee bit of chat about any gossip that's been happening, what's been happening with Motherwell, St Johnston, anything we've heard that MD for the BBC's been up to, and then we'll go up the stairs and then we'll go through all the notes I bring in for the week, and then we'll decide what we're going to talk about. And then after the shows, we say our farewells at 7 o'clock outside the BBC.
And our main contact during the week would be if there's some dick on Twitter. He lurks on it and I'm on it by the time, so I'll turn around and say, you clocked this, right?
And I invariably have. But I think that's maybe what keeps the show going as long, because like you say, some folk with marriages that last forever, and it's because a couple, they don't live in each other's pockets. Maybe the guy or the woman work away and they maybe go weeks and end without seeing them. They think, God, they've lasted forever, 60 years married. No, maybe it's the same thing with us on the show. You don't get sick of the sight of one another.
So you didn't go about with the Dennis and Young team?
No. I mean,
he barely comes over there. Much more posh.
It's more like the Nakadar grill the last time I was in Dennis.
Oh, lovely, isn't it?
And probably in the odd time it would actually hook up, it would invariably involve a curry and a couple of drinks or something. Yeah.
Living the dream. Right, we always ask footballers how they made it. How did you know make it? Were you hopeless? Football.
Football?
Yeah.
Yeah. Well, I played primary school football for the school. I went to a secondary school, which Perth Academy, where football was kind of frowned upon. It was a rugby school.
Rugby, yeah.
Played rugby for the school, basketball, volleyball. And I did a wee bit of kind of what in the Perth area they called city boy football. And then when I went down to university in Hull, I played for the university. But I never really, I'm not trying to claim that I was any good. I wasn't very good. I could play, but I wasn't very good. My only claim to fame in the footballing pitch was that I was at university with a guy called Tony Galvin, and he signed for Spurs, right? Oh, he was studying Russian at the time at Hull University. And as part of his deal, he'd moved from the university to a team called Goole Town. They were a big local team in the Hull area, and then down to Tottenham Hotspur. And as part of that deal, the university team got to play Goole Town in what was really a fundraiser for the university team. And I played on that day. And the centre forward for Goole Town was who? Take a guess. Of all the people that have lit up Scottish football, Charles Green of Rangers.
Oh,
he was the striker for Goole Town.
Was he any good?
He was actually a very, very good player. You'd be surprised. He was one of these guys. You know how you get guys that have actually got a lot of kind of beef about them, a bit of pace and whatever? So he was their striker. He was pretty good, yeah. Pretty
and what position did you play?
Oh, well, I was actually that day playing as a quality sweeper. I was the Pat Stanton of the team, you know.
Charles Green's career, though, blighted with injuries and, you know, and all that. He used to get Jim White at the boat with his bed and all that. Jim would only have been about 14 at the time.
Yeah. What about you, Tom?
See his pal. Well, you're saying we never made it. I got a call this morning from Steve Clark. he thinks I've still got his on the offer. Having watched that last night. But no, I'd win. Similar story to Stuart. Primary school with me and the Boys Brigade were the two teams I played with, and I eventually chucked it when the eyes started to go. And one memorable instant, I had been playing with the BBs. We were playing actually in what was a grass park, which has now been really, really tarted up at Braidhurst High School in Motherwell for the Football Academy, where they've got the really, really top-end facilities. Once upon a time, there was just a grass park there. We played our BB games there, and we were playing this company, and my eyes were starting to go, and I was kind of like the old-fashioned right half, a number four jersey in my back, and the eyes were starting to go, and at one point, it was a wee player on our team, just a wee guy, it was in the BBs, Rab Monroe, who stayed just up the road for me in Jersey and Motherwell, and he was doing injured. And there was boys that were there watching the other BB team that we were playing. At one point, I'm watching this, and a guy who was watching it, wee Rab's doing the grin, chucked a half brick at him, right? A BB game, right? Well, I went, I was the captain of the team, and I charged in, and the referee, I went, yeah, I swore, you never swear in the BB's games, right? Mm. And I said, did you know F and C that, you know? And right away, red card, bad language, off the pitch, and I get sent off. And as I'm walking by, I'm not to see how wee Rab was, my eyes, the half bracket had been thrown on him. It was a wet sponge, which they'd been very kindly thrown on to help him. And I thought, oh, catch me, my eyes are fucked. I'm wrapping it.
He's a both well-known supporters, Motherwell, St Johnstone. Yeah. What got you into supporting those teams and avoiding the big two?
Just life. I grew up in Perth. I grew up, I could see Muirton from a bedroom window. My dad died when I was a young boy, and he was a big St Johnstone fan. But my uncle Billy, who kind of became, if you like, my kind of surrogate or adopted dad, he looked after me, and he was a mad, mad keen St Johnstone fan. And when St Johnstone were away and he couldn't get there, he'd go and see Jeanfield Swifts. Just one of these guys that would always go to a live game, you know. And he would take me for the age of, like about eight or six or eight, maybe something like that. And then my cousin Russ, who ended up playing for Arbroath and Brechin and teams like that, we would go together to all the games, but it was always St Johnstone. And often that was, you know, I was actually looked in a history book of the team, and I remember it'd be about 61, an away game, and we'd drawn Queen of the South in the cup. And I remember my mum saying, no, that's far too far, this is ridiculous. And my dad worked for the Cope, and he'd this big lorry, and he was taking St Johnstone fans on the back of the lorry down to Dumfries, right? And I remember, we must have been about Stirling way, we were out of Perth anyway, and I peed myself, right? I was a wee boy, and I wet my pants, and the humiliating thing was that they took my jeans off, so I was sitting in the cab, you know, with naked with the underpants.
This is what they tell the police when they arrived anyhow, right?
And here's my uncle Billy holding up the stinking jeans at the radiator. Remember them old radiators at the front of a lorry? Things that would catch flies and things like that. They were drying my pants, and it was cringe making. But that was, it was a 1-1 draw as well, so we got them back to Perth and whipped them.
And essentially, I was the same. It's support your local team. Mm. That's it. Stuart did it with St Johnstone.
Was your family with Motherwell? My dad
always even comes and goes with the football at the point. I'll give you a good example. My dad liked good football, like guys in my dad's vintage was. And he was blessed with a lot of great Motherwell teams in the past, came back to Ansel Babes and all teams like that. And you know what? A guy I never need any excuse to talk about. My dad literally went back to supporting Motherwell when we signed Davy Cooper, because my dad liked good football. And suddenly you were getting it with him, and when he teamed up with Bobby Russell in the midfield, you were watching the kind of stuff we hadn't seen for years at Motherwell. So my dad drifted in and out of football, but he absolutely encouraged me to go and see my team. And again, like Stuart, from my back door in Motherwell, I could see the floodlights at Fir Park. That always intrigued you if you were out playing with your pals at whatever Hunts or Kick the Can or whatever it might have been nowadays. And you could see, oh, look, the big glow in the sky, and that's Fir Park. And it was like seeing like the, you know, where the Wizard of Oz lived or something. You think, I wonder what's up there when you're wee. And then you'd gradually get Gallus Alice, and you'd up with your we kids knew that, you know, you can't go out your street and you can't go out doors and that. But we would go up and then you'd start the classic thing of getting the loft hour, which I see no reason why they couldn't still do that at clubs, particularly clubs like ours, where regularly there are acres of empty seats, you know, and you don't need to bring in rules and regulations about one kid per adult, or it's with an adult it's £2. Just don't negate. Let the Wains in, or let them get a loft there and say, there's 100 empty seats, you know, feel free. And they'll buy season tickets when they're older, you know. So it was as simple as that with me growing up then. Motherwell's my local team. I really don't like the idea that you folk that support a football team if it's based on religion or how many trophies they've won. I just can't see the point in that. It doesn't give you any great feeling for the club, and it's something that you'll always have for your entire life, I think, you know, supporting your local team. And how different the landscape of Scottish football might be if everybody did that, you know. And I was always taken by the thing that was in Frank Skinner's autobiography. It was a bit of that I'm talking about with a West Brom fan. And he said, as far as he's concerned, when it comes down to what football team you support, he says you should basically be able to take out a map and a ruler and look at your house in the map and just see where the nearest football team is and say, that's my team. And, you know, it'd be very interesting if everybody did that, you know. And that is to the point that the only regret, I think, that me and Stuart will ever have, maybe regret's too strong a word when it comes to 25 years we've done the show, is that we miss out on a hell of a lot of games.
Ah, you do.
Stuart, particularly with thankfully the geography, the BBC, being in Glasgow and my team being in Motherwell, 12 miles down the road, I can get in between our shows to all the home games, right? That's fine. I leave 10 minutes early just to get into the car park, get away, beat the traffic. But that's good because it means even on the way back, and I've got the radio and I can hear about all the other games taking place that day. And you're up to speed for doing the show at night. Away games, I'm very selfish. Like, even when you're, even just at this time of the year, I'm hoping for a deep frost and a Saturday, you know. Right, yeah. And again, maybe at Aberdeen or that getting cancelled. And
you're hoping a Tuesday night.
Magic, and make a day, maybe even stay out night, get a wee bevy. That just seems sensational, but it doesn't happen often enough.
Yeah.
Stuart gets times where
I'll get a St Mirren, Hamilton, Motherwell, Ibrox, Parkhead. And they're often moved to Sundays, some of those games anyway. So I'll get to all of them, but you're struggling.
I'm really
struggling for Pittodrie and struggling.
Your ideal league would be in a Celtic, Rangers.
Well, the Dundee team's been out's good.
Celtic, you'd want Celtic, Rangers, Motherwell, Hamilton, St Mirren.
Albion Rovers.
Kilmarnock.
It's not too bad. You can just about do bad. That.
Need that.
Still so, Albion?
Airdrie.
But the thing is, we don't
about to do Stirling,
you know, we're not in there playing dominoes or anything on a Saturday if we can't get to a game, because we're fortunate in the respect that you can watch the games coming into the building. So you can always sit and watch you don't even need to do that. You can just sit and watch the games without any commentary and that.
What kind of fans are you? Are you shout ballers and shouters? Are you boos?
Oh, I'm in Bert Payton. I'm sure Bert Payton isn't watching, right? He was at Dunfermline for a while. Dear old Bert Payton, a great player these days, a Fife legend, a Dunfermline legend, synonymous for wearing the bonnet when he was at Dunfermline. He probably just
synonymous for being the number two at St Johnson under Alec Thornton.
See, there they go. And I think he just kind of maybe preceded Jimmy Calderwood.
He did die.
But Bert was there. And I had Bert by that point on the radio waves. He'd been on the telly and everything. And at one point, there was a Motherwell player went into the box. We're playing the film. It was a midweek game, and we're just up to the left as I'm watching it. Motherwell player went into the box, and there was a Dunfermline player went right in, scythed him, brought him right down, penalty, you know. And Bert Payton was out, and he's shouting, and you know. And I says, "What? I'm thinking, is he blind?" And I remember I just stood up and says, "Are you fucking blind, you daft bonneted old daft?" You know. And he must have heard every word. And he turned round, and it was a strange kind of wee moment, because he turned round and he looked at me and he saw me and he says, "I was shouting at my own defender, Tom." He was raging at his guy down a stupid challenge when he was no need for it and conceded a penalty. And I just kind of went back down and said, "Sorry, mate." But all that
quite
stuff,
I
mean, it's the best place to sit, obviously. We used to always have to, we didn't have to, we chose to stand behind the goals at Motherwell, me and all my pals. That was where we always congregated. And then when they were renovating Fir Park and doing all the stands and all seating and all the rest of it, we thought, right, if we do have to get a seat, at least let's get a good one where we can see all the game and all that. So it's perfect.
So you're in amongst it, you're no prawn sandwich, is it?
Oh, no, I never,
never take anything. Never once in my life.
We always get asked. The last time I got asked was by... it's for Bell Sill, and he was involved in the Players Union. He's playing with Clyde still.
John Rankin.
John Rankin, it was the last time we had him on our show. Another time we got him, the Clyde gig.
Remember that? That's right, they called him live on air.
We're always good. For him that comes on our show, if they're out of work, we'll get you a gig. And the best example of that was John Rankin. He was on our show, and we were saying, you're available for work? Absolutely, I'm still fit, keep myself in good shape. And one of the Clyde directors contacted the show while we're on air, saying, could you get John to give me a call? And the next thing he'd sign the contract, you know? Yeah. Brilliant.
In fact, he's featured in one of our best ever limericks. There was a young man called Rankin.
But he, one day, was on our show, always remember us, and I came up to the the car park at Murrowell. That's the only thing I ever take out the club. I gave the club plenty. I asked for a space in the big car park so that... It's just a time hang. I can't be, by the time I arrive after the first show, I can't be driving around all the streets in Motherwell trying to get parked or I'll miss the game. And then when I get out, I don't want a big long walk and I'd never see the second half even there again. So they allow me, excuse me, into the car park and that's fine. But one such day, I parked the motor, I'm going to get into a season ticket, but taking out my season book when it was a book, it's now just a wee credit card thing. And John Rankin's walking up with one of his boys, and he's clearly heading for the same gate, which is also the complimentary bar gate. And he said to me, he says, where are you going? As if, you be
coming in here?
The red carpet rolled out and you got there, number three course. I says, no, this is where I'm getting my season ticket. Yeah. And he couldn't fathom that you would have a season ticket and you'd put money into your club. And that's the only way for him to ever say to us, it could be a football message board, it could be a manager that's listening to something you've said in the show. What gives you the right to say that? Say the only right, the only thing gives me the right is that I'm a paying punter. Always paid my money, I'm entitled to my opinion, end of. Yeah. And the minute you stop doing that, then that's it, you're dumped.
So I go to the East Stand at St Johnstone, so I'm
you'll buy a season ticket and sometimes and barely get to the games,
you know. Yeah. And, you know, I don't go to the main stand where the hospitality is, so I'm at the other end of the ground, beautifully positioned, actually, on the halfway line. And one of the reasons why my ticket's there is I can look right down onto the edge of the halfway line, and my Uncle Billy, who brought me up, is buried there, and always had his seat quite near there as
ashes.
Well.
His ashes. He's no fucking buried there. That would be gross. Buried, he's not physically buried. Sliding tackle on a Monday day, not
strange you should say that, right? There was a game I was at, later part of last season, and there was somebody, you know how fans hate when somebody tries to steal yards at a throw-in, right? This guy was going absolutely tojo at somebody. I can't even remember who it was now. And he says, the ball went out where Bully's buried, and he's fucking away up the other half.
Right, so what I've took for that is you'll take nothing off St Johnstone and Motherwell, but you'll charge me a fortune for an interview. Right, no worries. Next
A fortune?
A fortune?
Lashers. The definition of a fortune would be
what? It would be a fortune. Maybe he'd been a player we'd heard of. Yeah. Right. Somebody had maybe done something in the top flight. I'd get you on Wikipedia. Yeah.
Right, we're going back to your to go to your media. How you got in the media. You wrote jokes. I sent them in and got read out on Radio 4. Which was always comedy that you wanted
Wikipedia.
To get. Great research.
Right. I always enjoyed a laugh, a joke, and a carry on. So when I was in 6th year at the high school, I had got my exams and all. I wasn't a SWAT at the school. I was joking earlier about the 2 O grades, but I got my O grades, I got my hires, ran to 6th year, had to do something. I did 6 year studies, English and history, and our English department were starting a wee writer's workshop, as they called it, to get local adults to come in and take part in things. They needed some pupils to go along in the uniform to be there and all that. I went along, and while folk were writing wee short stories and stuff like that, I was writing sketches and wee topical jokes and all that. English teacher sent some of them into shows on Radio 4 and Radio 2. Some of them get used, became a big deal, gave me a wee feeling for it. And that's what I was kind of doing when I should have been studying at Napier College. But I was sending jokes away to folk well before your time, like Little and Large and Hale and Pace. You had Naked Radio in Scotland, Naked Video, Scotch and Rye. Only an excuse. I was honoured to have had some stuff on that when it was the old audio tapes, when that was in its infancy. Particularly because I was into football, it was a big, big thrill. The producer stroke creator of that, Phil Differ, was instrumental in giving me a wee start and stuff. So I was doing all that, and then that got me into a column with the Evening Times, 1990, which at a time when fanzines were hugely popular, every club had their own print edition fanzine. I was writing that kind of style of stuff in a strip column, the Evening Times. That became two columns a week after a year, then three columns, so that was kind of like your job. And then it was through that, the producer, the original, if you like, first year of Off the Ball, Spotty Dances, oh, gee, time of trying this. And then by the time you were doing the paper and Off the Ball, in 98 then I get the move for the Evening Times to the Daily Record. And then in 98 you had a national profile with the paper and the radio. And then that's probably, I then started getting a wee bits of telly and that. And that's just the way it works.
Well,
I was one of these guys that never knew what I wanted to
do. Was the dream always to get involved in football
though? I think when I thought about going to Napier College, I probably had a wee fantasy about sitting in the press box and writing about Motherwell winning a cup or Scotland watching them at a World Cup against Brazil. That was maybe it, but then it took a wee slight left turn.
Simon, just for perspective, yeah, though, one of the sketches, which is truly honking, involves
one involves a
herd of cows being driven in the back of a car or something.
Oh,
like
I
that.
I remember that, I can get filmed. It would have cost a fortune. No, I know, I mean, example, you're putting this together for what, fucking 30 bob, right? Yeah. But this was BBC television, Little and Large. Do you remember Little and Large? The wee fat guy, and then Sid Little, the wee skinny guy, he played the guitar and all that shit, right? But they were hugely popular in like the 70s and into the 80s. And you're right, one of them that was sent in, it was the farmer. One of them's a farmer. And he's sitting with, driving a wee motor, and he's got two cows sitting in the back of the motor. And his mate in the farm says, "What are you doing?" He says, "You told me to drive the cows into the barn." I get made, I get filmed.
I prefer your story about pissing yourself in the back of the
My first ever joke, you like this one, first ever broadcast joke was in a show called The News Headlines, starring old Roy Hudd, who's up in the Perth Theatre.
Yes, he is, I noticed that, yeah.
With Isla Blair and Lisa Goddard. Yeah. It's an Oscar Wilde piece,
yeah.
Did a lot of your guests talk about Oscar Wilde? No.
I don't know who he is.
No.
Who did he play for?
Rafe Rovers. But anyhow, the first ever joke was on his radio show in Radio 2, 1987, and the gag was, there'd been a story that week that a plane in Australia, and a kangaroo that was on the plane had escaped for the hold of the plane. And the joke was, it must have been a Boeing 747.
That's good,
£7.50 I got for that.
Yeah.
Yep.
Yeah. You're getting a lot more for this. Right, Stuart, you started off in the musical side.
Yeah.
Is that what you wanted to get into?
Not really, no. I mean, I actually started off because I've always been, since I was about 15, I've always been a big fan of soul music and grew up all through my life. That's the big passion of my life. And what had happened was that at the time, I ran a soul club in Perth City Soul Club, and there was big clubs in Dundee, Edinburgh. So you go to these various local dos, but the biggie down south was at Wigan Casino. That was the big all-nighter. And I was down there right from the very start, and it lasted kind of about 8-9 years throughout the 70s. And I was kind of well known around there. At the time, I was also a student, so I'd moved down to the North England to study, in part because that was kind of one of the best ways of getting down on the Northern soul scene. And as a consequence of that, I was on the dance floor at Wigan one night, and this guy came up to me and says, "Oh, you can write. Why don't you write for the fanzine?" This is the Northern soul fanzine. And I started writing for that night. Sent him a piece, you had to handwrite it, send it in the paper, and somebody would type it up for you. It was all of that. I never had a typewriter, but it just got more and more, and then eventually I bought a typewriter, and then a kind of floppy disk computer that was single. I mean, we think it now, it was primitive, you know. Right. You had to kind of feed floppy disks into a little kind of slot and code it and crudely kind of try and write over it over the very early days of Word. And then I started to appear a lot in soul fanzines. And I wrote for a paper called Black Echoes, which was the big black music paper in London. And the editor of the NME spotted what I was doing, yeah. And I, therefore, I was the first journalist at the time, certainly in that kind of music scene, that went on a big transfer, right? They signed me from Echoes to the NME. I went there as media editor, and they paid Echoes a fee, cash fee, and also gave them a certain amount of advertorial about, you know, to advertise the smaller newspaper. And I went to the NME, and I became, within about a year, I was media editor, but I was also their American correspondent. So I was doing quite a lot of dance music, hip hop and house and things like that. And it was really quite a good experience, you know.
Go on, give us a few of the people you interviewed. Stevie Wonder.
Oh, hundreds. Prince, Stevie Wonder, James Brown, Marvin Gaye, I mean, all of the biggies, wow. All of the biggies. I always remember to tell this story about, I was due to interview James Brown, and it was a Saturday morning. He had said that he would do breakfast on a Saturday morning. He was doing a tour of the UK, and he had a new album out, so his record company wanted this interview for front cover of the NME. And I'm sitting down, and it was Hyde Park, it was the Dorchester Hotel in Hyde Park, and I'm sitting waiting. He no show, no, he's no there. 8 o'clock, 9 o'clock, 10 o'clock. And I had in my hip pocket a ticket for Scotland, England at Hampden. I was meant to be flying up on the 12 o'clock for a 3 o'clock kickoff. I was going to go at the game straight for the airport. And that was the day we won the Rouse Cup. I think it was 1-0 Scotland, Richard Gough scored. And I'm still sitting there with a brief with a ticket in my hand. And this wee nyaff, James Brown, didn't show up till about 3 p.m. And he says, first question, you're attempting to say, why are you a dick? You know what I mean? But I really didn't like the guy. He's arrogant. He's not a very nice person. And he's deep now, so you can really slag him, you know. But but that was one of the ones that sprung
to mind. Was there another one that you had to have a triple vodka early in the morning?
Oh, aye, that was... Did I tell you this story about Oliver Reed? I think I did tell you this. Oliver Reed, who at the time was kind of infamous for turning up on live TV shows and getting steaming and fighting with feminists. And I mean, he was a real kind of odd character, great character
actor.
Now? Yeah. Me too. And basically what happened was that he said that he would do the interview, and it was at his hotel where he was staying in Soho. So I went to the hotel to meet him, and I'm doing the interview, and he's quite assertive about his attitude to life. And he said to me, I'll do this interview if you drink along with me. And he just said, this was like about 8 a.m, and he goes to the hotel and he says, fresh orange juice and a, you know, 2 egg rolls or whatever it was, he had his fry up. He says, fresh orange juice with a triple vodka in it, please. 8 a.m. Wow. And he says, and he'll have the same. You're like, no, I wouldn't. Right. But anyway, he'll have the same. So I'm there drinking away. And of course, when about an hour and a half, I'm legless. But he's fucking still like this, you know. Nice. Big, big brute of a man. I mean, he poured drink down him and go right down to his ankles. Keep going. Anyway, we did a version of the interview, had the cassette with me. And as we came out, he was walking through this lane in Soho to to Wardour Street, I think it was, he was going. And we're coming out, and all I heard him shouting at the top of his voice, big, big beard, heavy set guy, he just turned around and said, you little shit, you. And I'm kind of looks around, and I can see coming towards me Ian Hislop, right? And he picked Ian Hislop up, he pinned him up the wall, and he said, you think you can be smart taking the piss out of me and telly? You're not so smart now. He looked down and he says, I can see diarrhea running down your leg, you posh little twat. And fucking crashed him down to the ground and kept walking. I'm going, hello.
Brilliant. You know the column that used to keep Stuart going when he was down in London?
What's that? When I was in Evening Times, that's how Stuart knew me.
That's the one.
Yeah, that's it. Absolutely. But we didn't meet. And that confident, I auditioned for that, if you like. There was a football journalist at the time, Graham Clark, who wrote for the Evening Times. And on a Wednesday, he had a big full page letters page. And when the Evening Times, their way of seeing if they were going to stamp me with a column or not, they asked me to effectively write a column that they would put in this letters page as a big letter. And they said, we'll stick that in, and if we get any sort of reaction to it, Tam, we'll give you a restart. That was, it was an audition, basically. So I did, I wrote about 800 words that they put in as a letter, and they got a good reaction to it. Oh, who was the boy? Tom. I was Tom then. Tom Cowan from Motherwell. We enjoyed that. It was a good laugh, blah, blah, blah. So they gave me a restart, and that was just, you know, a wee bit of endeavour, a wee bit of hard work.
I was in exile in London at this time, working at Channel 4, and I was flying up at the weekend and often going to see St Johnson. During the time, I can even remember the team because I was always getting them tickets for TFI Friday. And there's actually one bar scene in TFI Friday where if you watch it, you can see the whole St Johnson squad in there. Fizzy Scott, Kieran McInnesby and all of them. They'd gone down. I think there was no Saturday game, so they'd flown down on the Friday and got them tickets for TFI Friday. But so I was down in London and flying up on a Thursday night or Friday night. And, you know, when I say living in exile, it literally was that at the time, because there was no internet, you know,
and
you had this situation where I could get the Westminster version of the Daily Record. But basically what that was the English version, with maybe two or three games on the back, and we guess who those two games featured. and you'd get that, and that'd be about it. So you'd be coming up thinking, right, well, you know, starved the Scottish football. You know, you would get the odd phone call from a mate and he'd tell me of scandals that had happened. And then I arrived at Glasgow Airport and there was always the free copy of the Evening Times line. As you got off the plane, I'd grab it.
I didn't even buy it, you rotten bastard.
Anyway. So I went straight back, three pages back in, and I always started with Tam. No idea who he was, but you know what I liked about it? There was three or four things. I could list the things I liked. I love wee Snyders, where he pretends, Tam does this, pretends he's praising somebody, and as they're coming by, just claps them right in the face, right? He does that. The other one I love is, and you have to have the guts to do this if you really want to be funny, is go for the holy cows. And if you look at Rangers and Celtic, they were always up there. At the time he started, they were virtually untouchable. Aye. There was no such thing as a media that criticised them or held them to account or in any way really kind of mocked them.
And but so see, I was very
is that
lucky.
A plan of yours, Tim?
Well, I was very lucky that because I'm a Motherwell fan, and certainly when I was starting out then Reading Times, I was a Motherwell fan, and I was writing in a paper that was primarily purchased in and around Glasgow, where you're going to get Celtic and Rangers fans. So I was always able to balance it. You know, it's where it's right up to current date, right up to the last show we would have done the radio. There's always guys that will say, I know who you're really supporting, it's selling, it's Rangers. But that, for me, it's always flipped. It's one week, depending on who you've been taking the piss out of, you must all hate them, and then the next week it's other, you must hate them. As long as it's always balanced and even over the course of time, then absolutely fine. So I was perfectly placed for doing that column at the Evening Times when I started out. And what was a big, big help as well, because I started it in, it was actually January 91, it was January 1991 I started that, and that of course was the year where 5 months later or whatever, my team won the Scottish Cup. So that was a great help for me, as much as we make a joke now about how often I mention that in the radio and everything, still the only time I've seen my club win the major trophy, but it was a great help if there was ever a chance that I would have, you know, writer's block or a big blank page or whatever. What a start, because that Motherwell were really motoring then, you know, and it gave me a good help. There's always, you're thinking hundreds of things to write, you know. And, of course, along the way, you were doing, I mean, in that time you're talking about being able to get it up, Rangers and Celtic, for a Motherwell fan and a Glasgow paper. That year, we had, of course, beaten Celtic after a replay in the semi-final, beat them 4-2. And then the week before, we went and won the Scottish Cup final. We beat Rangers 3-0 at Fir Park. That's when the Rangers had maybe played for a draw.
Yeah.
Having to turn the heat out the Aberdeen game that they had to play the following week when Mark Catley basically won the league for them, you know. Mm. So there was all that stuff going on as a Motherwell fan. So it was brilliant for me starting out, making sure that I had plenty to write about, you know. So,
but just to give you perspective there, Simon, it would have been unthinkable going back to your own upbringing. You know, you had the Courier and the Tully, the Evening Telegraph in Dundee, but there wasn't as big a media around those clubs that would have made them the subject of humour in the same way. So Tam could only really have done that in Glasgow.
But what you had today as well, because the only real problem I had in the early days, which seems weird, was from Motherwell. Because the other thing that I had to make sure that I did as a Motherwell fan, and almost by way of a way of flashing my credentials, was to, when they deserved it, have a go at Motherwell as well.
Yeah.
And the tricky thing was, I had to have a go at Motherwell saying the sort of things that I knew my pals that I started the game with and all the rest of the fans were saying. Okay. I had to be in tune with them, you know. And the time that got me involved was maybe about a good year and a bit after winning the cup. By this time, we, Tommy McLean, had joined the board of directors, and there wasn't much money being spent to really improve the team and capitalise on what we'd done after the cup. And I had kind of slated them in a column, and I got the call. The call went in to my editor at the Evening Times, and actually it was preceded by a lawyer's letter from Jock Brown, the famous Jock Brown commentator, Craig's brother, who was acting as a lawyer for Tommy McLean. And this quite ridiculous letter gets sent into my editor, and it said that they took umbrage at, I'd said about Tommy McLean, it metaphorically, I says he's got to get rid of the sheep, now he's a director, get rid of the sheepskin coat and the cigars and get back, it's concentrate the dugout and get the team going again, get them out in the park. And it was this preposterous letter that came in lawyer speak, you know, but we would take issue with A, the sheepskin coat brackets, which Mr. McLean does not own, B, the cigar brackets, which he does not smoke. It was all that's ridiculous, right? So anyhow, it all worked out then, because what happened was my editor phoned me up and he told me everything that happened. He says, right, you know what I'll do? I'll go up and I'll see Tommy, you know. So I always remember, I thought, I'm representing the paper here. I remember putting on a collar and tie. I thought, I'll try and do it all properly. Up and I saw wee Tommy. I went into his office. I can still see this like it was yesterday. And the minute I walked in, his wee face, that wee hamster face, he was absolutely beeling, right? And I sat down. What I'd taken with me, however, and I still got them, was my collection of season ticket stubs for all the previous years, you know. And he was just about to launch into one, because he thought, here's this guy writing a column in the Glasgow Evening Times. He must be a Celtic Rangers fan. Why the fuck's he slagging me and Motherwell and all, you know? So I went in and I says, Tommy, before you start saying anything, I'm a Motherwell fan. Anything that I'd written there is what I was hearing round about me at Fir Park from my pals, the folk that sat nearby me. And I says, if you don't believe me, and I brought out the wee box and all these, and I says, look, I've been a season ticket holder for I was 10, you know, and I could just see him gradually just deflate a wee bit, and the colour came back to his cheeks a wee bit, you know? And then we ended up, he was absolutely fine. He says, look, my hands are tied here, kid. I always remember saying, I can't just go out and spend money and all the rest. I might be, that's half the reason I went on the board, hoping to get them to loosen the purse strings a wee bit, blah, 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 blah. He was very, very good. And, you know, is it because he was my ultimate kind of legend, if you like, for the managerial side of things at the club. I was never going to let his criticism of me blind me to the, all the stuff that he'd done at the club. So he remains just a god.
So why did you thieve his wallet for the sheepskin?
Well, you can take the man out of the Motherwell, right?
What I want to ask you, who's the mastermind that brought you together then?
The mastermind?
Is there a guy that we can thank?
Well, actually, or there is. His name's Angus Lyon.
Angus.
He was a senior producer at the BBC, and he called me. I was actually doing stuff for Radio 5 Live at the time, and or it was maybe just called Radio 5 at the time, and he had heard me doing a late night show there.
And you'd had the Hamden
and I'd had Hamden Babylon in the books out, and that had done really well, sold out, reprinted three times, that kind of thing. And that was still having a laugh at the kind of scandals of Scottish football, slightly different approach to Tam, but there was kind of like a merger of minds there. And this guy thought, after their first year of Off the Ball with Sanjeev Kohli and Greg Hemphill and a guy called Ian Ross, they had a kind of zoo radio format, and he brought me in and said, how would you change this? And I said, well, there's just too many people, you can't make out who's speaking, there's just too many voices cutting over each other, and some of them are trying to be funny more than actually passing any relevant comment about football. I'd heard he'd given me some tapes of the show to listen to. And I said, well, you know, the Tam Cowan guy, who already knew for this column in the Times, I said, he's the one, he's the funny one, and he knows about football. And funnily enough, it ended up that we were the only two people in the room that regularly went to see a team week in, week out, you know.
Did you two hit it off straight away?
Yeah, pretty much so,
Well, we had a similar upbringing. I mean, everybody kind of reckoned that we were poles apart in terms of what we did for a living, and Stuart being the Channel 4 guy and the guy who'd been on The Late Show and wearing the trendy shades indoors and all stuff like that, right? And juking about with the hooded tops and all that. And I was your wee man with the Stay Press and the Y cardigan for Motherwell, you know? But we'd both been brought up in and housing schemes, council housing schemes,
where football was the first language, you know.
And we both support a wee diddy team, so there was always going to be a wee bond there. I would like just to, you know, looking back, well, I wouldn't even be sitting here now, but what the dynamic would have been if one of us or both of us had supported Rangers or Celtic.
Yeah, I think it probably wouldn't have worked. I'm sure it wouldn't have worked.
See, we were able to bring in, in the same way that Stuart said it when I'd started out of Cowan, we were able to put into a mainstream newspaper the sort of stuff that was in fanzines and all that at the time, right? But the same token then, when we were able to go on the radio and suddenly just tut-tut at Celtic Rangers rather than be suki-suki-suki. And an era when programmes like Friday Sports Scene and that were turning up at Ali McCoy's door with a birthday cake and all that crawly stuff. Yeah, you know what I mean? Exactly. Well, I don't know who it was. I'm using that as an example. I think that actually happened in the news and STV. Yeah. Might have been Jim White doing it, but you wouldn't get them doing that for a player at Dundee United or Forfar or something, you know what I mean? So when we were able to go in and immediately have the fans of all those other clubs on your side
backing you, because
did you just get a free reign? Was it left up to you?
The usual boundaries of taste and decency, which Stuart would have known for working in television, and I even knew in the relatively short 4 years by that time that I'd been in newspapers. You know it's pointless you writing something when it's just going to be cut out. You know,
so you can't do things that are libelous.
No.
And you can't do things necessarily that would inflame kind of, you know, criminality or, you know, there's a set of kind of broadcast regulations. But, you know, next to that, there's some people go on about what's offensive. Well, what's offensive is in the eye of the beholder. You know, I actually find some jokes very, very funny, and the next person might think, oh, that was a wee bit close to the bone.
Do you get it from Celtic and Rangers fans?
When we started out, you had all the fans, all the other clubs who never ever get the same put in the spotlight as much as Celtic Rangers. So they were all on our side immediately, particularly when we're suddenly taking the piss out of them. But if you take the piss out of Celtic, various things that have happened things that have happened at Celtic, signing Raphael Shite, having John Barnes as manager, Dr. Joseph Henglos, when you've all things like that, and we're taking the piss, then the Rangers fans all love it. And then whenever it's happened to Rangers, the absolute implosion, financial disaster of the club in 2012, when that's happened, you're taking the piss out of that, then the Celtic fans love that. So as long as you're always mixing it, and honestly, what really hurts me, and I don't get offended then, so I'm not going to use that word, but what really hurts me is the folk that genuinely think that we support one of the two teams.
Deep undercover.
Where have you been? Just back to off the ball, what changes did you want to make when you first went in? Was it more taking the piss out of people as well?
So, aye, there was a bit of that, but the main one was actually, you know, was actually a change to the format. So basically what happened was that through conversations with this guy, Angus Lyon, and through doing the show week in, week out, gradually it became a double act, rather than what it had been, Zoo Radio. And of course, if you look back over the double acts of all time, they have to be different, right? So we started to exaggerate the difference between us, even although, as Tam said, we'd had similar upbringings and that. And clearly, you know, because of all my university stuff and that, it made sense for me to be the pretentious one, the kind of over-intellectualising one, the kind of slightly fey one, the daft clothes, all of that stuff. Yeah, yeah. And it made more sense for Tam to be the working class guy for the housing scheme.
And we
just kind of exaggerated
and
those realities.
Stuart summed it up beautifully, and I'm going to use a word to you that, of course, would never be used modern day, and would certainly never repeat it in a broadcast, but it was a word that he could have used back then. But Stuart summed up the two as by saying that I was the coarse lump of Lanarkshire lard, and he was the posh Perthshire poof. and to set the shop like that was kind of a good thing to hang on.
And you know, when you actually think about that, it allows you also to kind of mine different areas of humour as well. So, for example, Simon, if I'm talking about, say, St Johnstone and Motherwell, we've both won a cup, but we've also had long seasons of winning nothing. And so, therefore, if you reflect on, say, Vladimir Mayakovsky's theories of modernism, one of his big things is less is more. That actually the less you win, the more you cherish the wins that you had and whatever. And so I can make a quote like that and he's there ready to just pull me down, right? And you have to do it. I sometimes go there thinking, I now have to use a preposterous word that no normal person would use, knowing that he's going to come back at me, you know. You so you set up stuff like that.
So it's all planned out ahead.
Well, it's not planned in the sense that we have a script, but we know the roles that we play, you know. And
you could never do our show with a script in it. The script amounts to Stuart having timings on what you would cut, just so he makes sure he goes to the news of it. We've got to cross to go to Richard Gordon to talk about sports sound. But the script, I mean, I'm the whole week in the 29 years that I've had in newspapers, I always kept a shorthand version of it happened every day. And then I still, to this day, I bring that in with me on a Saturday morning. I've got the stuff for the week. And then once we've had our initial first coffee, a wee chat and gossip and everything that's been happening, me, Stuart and Stevie, our current producer, we'll go upstairs into another wee room and then we'll start going through this stuff. And then whatever it is that when we come to a wee story of the week that we all, oh, that might be good. Why don't we do that and talk about that? And then we think, right, okay, let's go with that.
And sometimes you're self-editing it. You're choosing items that will work in that. So just, you know, to give you an example today, Anthony Stokes is on the front pages, but because it's about domestic abuse, it's a difficult thing to actually turn into
and
humor.
And that's the thing that even, you know, that's the thing that we love know. It's because we've been on air for so long now, 25 years. There's many, they're making a documentary now for the BBC, for television, about the silver anniversary off the ball. And I was chatting to some of the guys that last week who are making it, and they were saying, off. And I was shuddering at the thought. And others said, when you listen back to some of the very early shows, some of the stuff you were able to joke about, some of the jokes you were able to crack, all the rest of it, you just know you when they get... But you've got to move with the times with that, you know.
Did you lose straight some away when you took over? Did it take off straight away, or did people take away like it used to?
Well, it kind of became successful relatively quickly, actually, and I think that was because
it was different. It was different. We're not, you know, and that's how. And I'm, you know, when you get
and it's slightly uncensored. We weren't. I mean, genuinely, it really doesn't bother me whether, you know, Anne Budge does or doesn't like me. It's just irrelevant to my life. So I don't feel constrained. I don't like to abuse people or hurt people or say things, and there's a lot of stuff that I would never ever.
But you know what, I'll tell you,
we
wouldn't be human if it wasn't the case that I'm trying to think, but if, you know, if somebody that we'd had in the show, whose company we'd enjoyed on the show, had been a good guest for us, I bet you if they'd got into a wee bit of bother, maybe they were managing a team and struggling a bit, and we'd fans slating them, there might be a wee bit of us that you're trying to give them a wee bit of support, and it's simply just because folk have done us a turn, becoming on our show and having a laugh and a joke is, and helping making, hopefully, a good programme. You know?
What about favourite targets? Craig Brown got it a bit for his off the pitch activity. Anyone else?
Oh, aye. Well, Craig was...
Craig went the first day of a go at himself with that. Craig's a guy that says that when the Scotland fans at one game, they all started, the first ever time they started chanting, Shagger Brown, Shagger Brown. And after the game, Craig had been speaking to his son, he said, did you hear that? And his boy says, it was me that fucking started it. So Craig likes telling that against himself. I remember years ago on the telly when we did a wee kind of kiddie on a fast quiz at the end of every show, and Craig was a guest and Craig won it, and it was at a time there'd been front page stories about Craig, you know, and he says, well, Craig, the prize we've got for you then is a very lovely 18-year-old, and I could see Craig, you know, and we got one of the guys to walk on, it was an 18-year-old bottle of whiskey, right, and that was that. But Craig loved that, and he tells me he still got the bottle, and we had it up made in his label with his picture on it and all that, you know, it's even it's only a laugh and a joke and a carry on.
But the thing is, we came in, it's slightly changed now, Si, but not completely, but there's a wee bit of change. We came into a period of time where there was all that kind of omerta stuff around what you said in the dressing room, and professional footballers tended to kind of club together and not criticise their fellow professional. And we've got this thing about it where somebody will take them down after the show down in the lift and they're slaughtering their entire teammates, but they come on here and they're like, oh no, he's a good professional.
Does that frustrate you when people are like that when they
come
on?
Aye. And very rarely, actually, that you get people that are as honest as they would like to be.
Yeah.
And the kind of level of kind of joking we're doing, we're looking for. Here's a thing. You ask a Scottish professional footballer, who is the biggest dud you've ever played against? They'll choose a foreign guy who's gone home.
Never going to listen to the programme.
Going to hear the programme, right?
The most candid with that, though, quite the opposite, albeit foreign football, if you like, was at the centre of it. Mm. We were doing a show once in Mixu, Patalainen was on. And Stuart says to Mixu, who's the one guy in football that you never get on with? And he just said right away, Henrik Larsson, Vanker. Right? And the whole history of Scottish football and media in Scotland, nobody had even said about a single bad word against Henrik Larsson. And here was a fellow Scottish football guy, albeit he's clearly Finnish. But here was a guy coming out and basically calling Henrik, the great Henrik Larsson, the king of kings, a wanker, live on radio.
You know, and what it was we like that Finland-Sweden rivalry. But there he was, and with that. And so there are some things, there are areas that you can joke about, and areas now that seem to have drifted away from being the subject to humour. And that's just as we've changed as a society. And it makes it tougher sometimes, but there are still areas that you can laugh at. You can still laugh at, you know, old-fashioned Scottish jokes about kind of, you know, overeating, poverty, bevy merchants, all the kind of Scottish stuff. You can still laugh at all of that. But as I was saying earlier, you know, something like spousal abuse and that, you just can't go there.
What about favourite guests then? Favourite guests that you've had on?
Oh, there's been so many different ones. And you know, sometimes I like people who come at it with a wee bit of difference, so that it's not always just the former professional, and they're maybe coming into the show. I'm trying to think of a really
folk who come in and enjoy. You just want to be. I mean, favourite guests can actually be somebody that just had a book to punt. And I mean, yeah. I don't even mean a player or an ex-player, just somebody that is a random in the studio, but actually he was pretty engaging, or he came out with, you know, a bad wee bit of material. Whatever you got, I mean, we've had all the first ministers and all that as guests. We've had your, in terms of the Scotland managers, Craig Brown, Alec McLeish, Walter Smith. Well, I'll tell you, Walter Smith was a favourite in one respect, that Walter, between Everton, Scotland, when he was basically without a gig, right, and we got him on, and it was when we were doing they did this...
Dalmellington in Ayrshire.
We were doing it the day of the show. And
the BBC were taking shows to this area in Dalmellington, and they chose our show to go there.
And basically, we managed to get Walter on this particular day, so we'd get they'd organised a lot of wee people carrier thing to take us down to the show. So Walter was great all the way down. He's chatting away quite the thing. It was great. Neither of us had met him before, you know, and he's chatting away, and he was good. He was great down there doing the show, great with the kids. And then when we came back, I always remember, for some reason, I remember this, it was Grand National Day, so it was around about April or whatever, and the way back up the road, we're in the M77, maybe it was still the A77 then, and we're just going by the King's Arms in Fenwick, and Walter says, right, we're not getting a pint or anything like that, you know, we've done the show and that, and he says, ah, brilliant. So we went into the King's Arms in Fenwick, you remember? Yeah. And Walter, he was brilliant with the punters and all that, and then he's chatting away to them all with a good drink and all that. So he was just great company, you know? Yeah. And of course, we can't do any form of any Scottish football show without praising Walter Smith. So
that's
the guidelines.
Thanks very much, Stan. Cheers. What about you, Stuart? Have you got one in particular?
You know, there's endless numbers of the people. There was, you know, there's a guy, actually, he's very young now, but Ray Bradshaw, the stand-up comedian, can be good because
he stands in for something sometimes, doesn't he?
Yeah. But Ray is a big Thistle fan who goes to the games and has his knowledge, so he gives you a perspective on Thistle. But what I loved about him is that he's grown up in a family where both his parents are deaf, so he's a sign language expert, right?
What?
Shocking. So basically he does sign language and, you know, all this stuff, right? My wee boy's quite good at it because there's a guy in the telly, Mr. Tumble, does it, Neil. So he'll say to me, toothpaste, you sign, right? This is my wee boy, he's 7-year-old. But Ray knows all it, and he's conversed with all his life. And he just tells this joke, which is probably one of the great sign language jokes of all time, where he's on the show and he uses the F word, right? Signed. And his mother says, that's it, you're going to have to wash your hands now, instead of washing your mouth. Yeah. So he's good at like that. He's got
And sometimes you get a wee surprise guest, which is a bonus. We were going in today at the show one Saturday back in 2003. It was the height of summer. 2003, there wasn't a European Championship or a World Cup on, so it was quite a quiet summer. I mean, we were walking in thinking, what the hell are we going to talk about today? And we opened the pages of the papers, and that very day in 2003 was the 25th anniversary that day of Archie Gemmell's goal against Holland. We thought, wow, that's us. So we asked, well, where were you? So it's going to be the Scottish JFK moment. Where were you when Archie Gemmell scored that goal? And all the stories were coming in. There was some really happy ones, guys saying that he'd walked his daughter down the aisle that day. Then they watched the game and they thought, oh, this day, greatest day of her life. Then another guy had buried his mother that day and he thought, oh, tears of sadness. Watched the game, then a few wee tears of joy, raised a glass. And then we're still taking calls, phone calls that day. You never do that now, text, emails. Never. Phone call came in next. Yes, caller, do you remember where you were when Archie Gemmell scored that amazing goal? And the voice said, aye, I was 10 yards for the greedy wee bastard screaming for a pass.
He's a Hartford.
He's a Hartford. He was living down in Sheffield. He was listening to us through the Sky telly or whatever. And he thought, I'll phone the boys.
What's great about it now, when you watch the goal, and I've seen it a hundred times, you can see it's
a wide screen telly.
And actually, there's a moment where Archie could just simply have slid it sideways to Aza and it was straight in, you know. Nobody would even notice.
Yeah, it's brilliant. You don't notice it until you notice it. Yeah.
Right, you've put me on the spot when I was on the show, asked me who my worst guest was. So there you go, I'm turning the table, Stuart.
Worst guest.
Pat, I'll jump in. Pat Kane, very rude, behaved like a child. We had him on, his brother Greg, a few in Cry fame. And alongside him was Ruth Davidson, the now former leader of the Scottish Tory Party. So as you can imagine, their politics are absolute poles apart. And it was just a horrible, horrible, horrible atmosphere, which we never try to have in an episode of Off the Ball, where Pat was kind of sitting with half his back turned to Ruth Davidson for the whole show. Outrageous body language, really rude. Anything she said at all, he'd be rolling his eyes, he'd be tutting very audibly, you know. And this went on for 2 hours in the lunchtime show. We tried to ignore it as it went on. We continued with the show, a laugh, a joke and a carry on. Ruth was very good. When you got Pat just on his own, it was fine, taking the piss out of him about his also propensity for the big long words like Stuart and all that. And we challenged the two of you.
Who could come up with the best one?
Yeah. Right? So we're still trying to have a normal show, but this was eating away at me. We finished the programme at 2 o'clock, as we do with everybody. We'd have done it with you. You go outside the studio and you get a wee photo for them to put up on social media and on the website and all. Well, up there, me and Stuart bookending the guests as normal. You've got Hugh and Cry, Pat and Greg, and you've got Ruth, and we're out either end. Just as we, Danielle, or maybe Chloe, one of the girls that works on the show, was just about to take the photo, she'd just about to go click, Pat just walks out of the shot and says, I can't do this, right? And I was up, you know, and we thought, oh, fuck. And he went away, him and his brother went away that way, Ruth went away that way, and for the rest of that day and the rest of that night, it was really, really eating away at me. We never want an atmosphere like that during a show. I was sitting in the house that night. I was in the house that whole Saturday night, sitting with a wee glass of wine, and I'm watching the telly, and my wife said, and I couldn't hang to me, but I was just like, what a fucking horrible, horrible day that was. What a horrible way to end a show. I phoned Stevie, our producer. I say, Stevie, how did you contact Ruth? Was it email? Was it phone? He says, no, I just had her number because Ruth used to work in the BBC and she was a journalist and she was on the radio. And so he says, no, I always had her number. I says, go on, give me it. And I want to just drop her a wee text. So I did. I dropped her a wee text. Now, this is where it seemed quite bizarre. He was me, a boy from Motherwell, who grew up in the shadow of the Ravenscraig Steelworks, phoning to apologise to the leader of the Tory party in Scotland. It just seemed really strange. And I texted her and I said, worst of it, look, I'm really sorry about that today, Ruth. Thanks for coming on. Me and Stuart feel horrible the way it all panned out there. And she got back, and I thought it was great, and I'm slightly paraphrasing here, but she basically got back and she says, don't worry about it, Tam. I had a great time in the show, and I've dealt with bigger arseholes than him. Mm-hmm. Full stop. And I thought, magic. And that was that. Well, it was horrible, wasn't it?
Yeah, one of the things about it, which to summon that up, We have an attitude which is like a wee bit like the old attitude that you had in Scotland about Hogmanay and New Year when folk come first footing you, that you kind of, even although, I mean, there's loads of people that have come on the show that I completely disagree with ideologically, Archie McPherson, for example, and, you know, you know, and if I end up stand up rounds.
Can I tell them, Archie McPherson's story?
Aye, please.
Right.
Yeah,
what's your parameters here? Go with for the words, right? I don't, because unlike Stuart, I'm a big fan of old Archie, right, but I'll use the word cabbage in this story when I might, he may have used another C word, right? How about that, right? I'll use the word cabbage.
Right.
It was another C word to use, right? Archie had said to me after one of the shows a couple of years ago, Tom, you're still doing the restaurant reviews, yeah? And I says, I've got a few spare afternoons, you know? I says, Archie, that'd be great. I'll take you out for a meal, that'd be great. Give me plenty to write up about. I'm out with Archie McPherson, great. So I'm like, where'd I meet up with Archie McPherson, you know, big aloof, the doyen guy, the BBC stalwart and all that, right? The voice of Scottish football. So I thought, I'll meet him, Archie. I said, we'll get you in the Regano in Glasgow, right? Oh, of course, yes. And I thought, we'll go to the Regano, I'll meet him there, we'll get a few drinks, and then we'll go downstairs to the Cafe Regano for the actual review. Wee bit cheaper, wee bit easier on the eckies and that, right? That's expenses, so I know your sort, all right?
Eckies are tablets that you take before a rave dump.
I was
lighting up there. But anyhow, so I met up with Archie this day. We're in the Regano, in the lovely bar upstairs. So, Archie, how are you doing? Glad you can meet. What can I get you? Oh, and he's looking about, it's a place for it. Champagne, I guess. I says, right, fine, champagne. So I don't even like it, but I had it as well. So two is a stone there. And I'm there with Archie McPherson, who had listened to Dane the Football. It was either him or Arthur Montford when I'm a kid. And I'm there in his company and he's regaling me with the stories. We get down the stair for the dinner and a few extra drinks had been taken by then and we're chatting away. And at one point, I don't know why, a guy has here, I brought up the name David Coleman, right? And the minute I said that, Archie just went, what a cabbage. Oh, a complete cabbage of a man, right? And he spouted this venom about David Coleman and how he hated him and everything about him and, you know, this, that and the other. And I'm sitting there like, this is Archie McPherson, wasn't it, here, you know? And this is clearly no for me to put in the review or anything, right? So I was stunned by this. One day later, after I'd been in there with him, the news comes on during the day. David Coleman has died, right? Yeah. That night on Scotland Tonight, the STV show, Archie's on as a guest. Archie, what did you think? One of our finest broadcasters, the greatest of his generation, he'll be sadly missed. You know? And I go, only Archie, you two-faced cabbage. Right. And he get back and he says, Tam, I'll do anything for 150 quid.
Oh, tremendous.
I says, I don't we all. it was brilliant.
What about you, Stuart, at worst?
At worst, you know what? His name's just gone out of my mind now, and it shouldn't have done, but I think he might be on loan, or maybe he's actually a third-choice keeper at Aberdeen now, but used to be Hamilton's keeper.
Cherney,
Thomas Cherney, right?
Big hit for himself.
Himself.
Very precious, aye.
Tosser,
couldn't he take a joke in any time.
And you know what? Here's the other thing about him. At St Johnstone had played a game against Hamilton, at Hamilton, and it was one of these games where Hamilton had gone 1-0 up, but we were battering them for 90 minutes. And you know these games where you just think they're just going to kind of suck you in.
Aye.
And McKinnon's going to chalk somebody down and all of this sort of stuff. And it was just Hamilton and Cherney was in goal. And the ball would come and it would be maybe a kind of by kick. And then he would go down with his hamstring and he'd be stretching it like that. And then eventually he would get up and kick with the other foot. He wasn't even kicking with the one, you know, and he was driving
nuts. I think he might even have started that one. The goalies don't know when they catch the ball and then they get down.
Then they fall
and then they roll out. You know?
And Thomas Cherney came on the show, but God, he was one of the most arrogant, you know. He just sort of sat there. I remember he sat over staring at us. Staring over the desk at us.
You know, I think it was Seth Meyer or Lev Yashin. Thomas Cherney, you know. And I think as an obvious, maybe his guard was up a bit and he thought we were slaughtering. But actually, if MD forensically looks at the show, that's not what we do. I'll give you an example of that. And actually, while you're talking about goalies, the first time we had Cammy Bell on, right? Now, Cammy Bell was relatively fresh for throwing that one into the net at Fir Park, the playoff, which was a huge, huge deal to me that it maybe even saved our club keeping us up that year, you know. So it was mega, and Cammy Bell was absolutely tortured for that. He was flamed for that night. But when he came onto your show, as much as it would have been easy for me as a Mullow fan to ha-ha-ha, remember that, you know. In the interim period, I always remembered that he'd played a game with Dundee United where he saved three penalties in the one game. Do you remember that? You know, so that was the starting point. And we went, "No, brilliant, catch you, you're back, Cammy. Well done." Because that must have been a hard time for you. But three penalties, there's no many guys have done that. Mm. We'll put it out to the listeners. They've ever seen Emdy saving three penalties, blah, blah. Mm. And that's the way I think we would always like to treat guests, you know. I have a laugh and a joke. If you get a good guest in and you did something that actually did genuinely upset them or offend them, we don't want them to believe me. Well, I'm never going on that
again.
But, you know, there's nothing to be gamed.
What about biggest mental case? Tommy Sheridan was a bit mad on it, wasn't
he? Oh, aye, Tommy, he'd be straight up there, you would have thought, as well.
First time we had Tommy, remember this, is we almost said this simultaneously. It was in the old BBC. Tommy had, so this would have been maybe back, I don't know, about 2002 or something, I don't know where that was, but we're at Queen Margaret Drive. We'd finished the first show, Tommy had been the guest, and on the show had been everything about the fact that he didn't smoke, the fact that he didn't drink, the fact that he was a keep fit, you know, squeaky clean and all that. And I always remember we were coming out, Tommy drove by us to go away, we took the horn, see you later, boys. And we turned to each other and says, "Well, what does he do?
Yeah.
What is he up to?"
Oh, no, no,
and then you roll on a couple of years.
Yeah.
And it all kind of unraveled a wee bit. You know, but no, you know what? Tommy is a guy that's, I know Tommy really well. My missus was at school with his wife Gail and all that, and we'd known him for years, gone to events with him, sat there with him. And so I've got to concede that Tommy's like a pal, and I was always willing him well through his troubles and that. But first and foremost, and it goes back to the great guests and that, politics and everything. I don't, Stuart will tell you, I'm not the least bit political. I keep an eye on the political world as much as I have to, and I can sometimes surprise Stuart on the area.
A wee nugget, something I drop in
that Stuart, I didn't think Tom would have known about that. But so I'm up to that, but irrespective of somebody's politics, Tommy Sheridan has been, and hopefully will be again, a great guest, one of our all-time favourites, and a lot of folk will have a lot of stuff to say about his politics, George Galloway.
Oh,
and
absolutely,
a sensational guest. George, he was on our show with us once, and he suddenly, somebody for some reason, I hope you remember us, somebody for some reason, the show or an email or something, mentioned bees.
Yeah.
Bees, 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 bees. George Galloway then, it was like a 15-minute
lecture on the history of bees.
On bees,
you know,
about how important bees are to the planet and what they do in the pollen. And but he spoke without repetition, hesitation, and he just does, you know, it was like he was back in the American Senate, absolutely battering the Yanks. He just spoke eloquently, beautifully about bees for about 15 minutes.
Has a footballer ever shocked you being that eloquent? Or are footballers always quite basic?
No. Footballers can be pretty eloquent. I mean, more the modern ones, you know, ones, guys that have gone through academies and stayed on at school longer.
You'll know them better than us, but the guys that have done the degrees
Stuart
and all
Armstrong,
that.
We've
never had Stuart Armstrong, but you're right, any time, the first time, when he popped up doing tele interviews and that, you're right, it was a wee bit, God, listen to this guy.
Remember,
you know,
when Jack Ross came on, it was because he was a child author.
Oh, that's right.
So you get these guys that are actually quite bright and have just got a wider life, you know?
Right, we need to talk about Jose Kitongo. What was your thoughts when he dropped the
carriage? Well, I'll start the story and then I'll let Stuart tell you how he saved our bacon. But Jose Kitongo was on a great. Have you had Jose on this?
No.
Great wee guy. You'll have met him and stuff. lovely wee guy. Almost to be this real sense of honour. A lovely wee guy. Lovely wee beautiful face. He's a great wee guy. Big sparkling eyes and a right wee polite man. He came on our show and he was talking about some of the horrible racist abuse that he had received in Scottish football.
It was actually against St Johnstone, the game.
The game.
I was at the game, I remember it actually. When? And what we Hosey said, he'd been at it, he'd been going down too easy, as they say, or whatever. And he was describing this whole experience of being shouted at for the terraces, and he was generalising around, you know, some of the kind of racist abuse he'd had. And then he came to this incident where he used the C word. And he said, actually, the words that he used is, he says, I'd gone down looking for a penalty and they were calling me, oh, the cunts, he said, right? And it was the way he said, oh, the cunts, right?
Right, Scottish,
right? Right, Scottish thing. And then, so I explained, as you do to the
very
regulator,
quickly,
that, you know, here was a man talking in his third language. He was an Angolan war orphan who'd had to come to Portugal and learn Portuguese and then come and move to Lanarkshire, where he learnt Scots and has lived in a Scottish life with two children. Both have been age group players for Scotland,
yep.
And his wife or girlfriend that he was living with at the time. And, you know, you think to him, well, I couldn't swear in Angolan, let alone Portuguese, yeah. Let alone, you know.
But so see the minute Stuart chucked at, and the fact that he'd been talking about racism, the racist abuse that he'd received, and the fact that Stuart had been totally sympathetic about this was his third language, we didn't get a single complaint about that.
Not one.
It's the sort of thing that you thought you'd get loads of complaints, but because of the way it had been pitched, I think it's even the serial complainers who would have thought, he said the C word, I'm complaining BBC. They might have thought, oh, for everything that he's been through and the way Stuart had explained it, if I complain, it's me that's going to be the bad guy here,
yeah,
you know?
Yeah.
So we never got a single complaint.
Yeah.
It was utterly bizarre.
For the avoidance of doubt, Simon, he's a diving wee cunt.
Going too, down too easy, letting that off Frank McAvenny, didn't he?
Yeah.
Yes. Frank's on here quite a bit as well.
Oh, Frankie boy.
Have you had Frank on?
Yes, many a time and often, the Rialto.
If he just sits at peace, he's all right. Yeah,
hey.
Frank's too fidgety, isn't he?
Hey,
he's distracted, he's always moving about.
Tam, here's an exclusive, right?
Yes.
Which is when you're in a studio...
Oh.
You should not have conversations.
Can I tell us?
Yeah, tell it.
He'll tell it beautifully.
Absolutely.
Frank's best moment at the BBC was one that wasn't broadcast,
yeah.
But it quite so easily could have been, because he was in the studio. He was doing Kenny McIntyre had been doing a series of special programmes with well-kent Scottish football celebrities who had been there and done it. And wow, Frank McAvenny's been there and done it. Celtic, West Ham, Scotland, a fabulous goal scorer in his day. And then you've got all the extras that go with Frank, the colourful lifestyle, etc. But so Kenny was in the studio with Frank and they're recording this show. And then Kenny gets a call that he's got to go and take another call. So Kenny, pre-recorded in out. Kenny says, Frank, I've just got to go and take a call now. Can you just, I'll be back in 2 minutes. Ah, that's fine. So Kenny went away, but everything that was in the studio was still being recorded, right? Frank's phone goes, and he thinks, well, I can answer it now. And he answers it. Now, somebody later let me hear this, what was recorded, right? Frank takes it as a joke now as well. But anyhow, all you can hear when I heard this audio of what happened, you hear just... Then you hear Frank as he goes, hello? Aye. you're fucking right. The neighbours must have thought I was fucking murdering you last night. And then when I was actually, I said, well, I don't want to hear anybody. I said, there might be some law against that. You're eavesdropping in somebody's conversation.
Yeah.
Piers Morgan, I know. honestly, I tell...
Comedy gold.
Because
he's having a conversation. I think it was with a girlfriend down in Newcastle, and he was talking about the night before.
It was his... Don't get him in bother after us. It was his partner.
Newcastle. He was living in Newcastle at the time.
All right, definitely his current partner.
Yeah,
we don't need to make that story worse than it was, but you know, it was great. After I'd heard it, by sheer joy, perfect timing, about a week later, I was doing a do up at Motherwell, emceeing a do up there, and who had they got booked to speak at it but Frank McAvenny, right? And I'm saying, I stood up, well, Frank McAvenny, you know a lot about him. I says, but boy, a wee thing that I learned recently about Frank, and I told that story. See, just when I started telling it, you think he couldn't embarrass Frank McAvenny? His face went just increasingly scarlet.
Oh,
but he loved it. He had a good laugh at it. Frank can laugh at himself.
Yeah,
that's what you know about.
Yeah. Right, what I wanted to ask as well, have you ever received backlash from a player or a manager for something you've said on the show?
Yes. I'd get one that was disappointed in. The guy's back in the news now. It was a few years ago, and a column that I'd written for the Record. Then there on the Saturday, in the morning today, the radio, the column was in the paper, and I got a phone call with no number on it, and it was Kip Broadfoot ladling into me for the column that had been in the Record that morning. But when I looked back at the column, the only thing I thought you could have had any issue with was the headline. And I tried to explain it. It was his dad. He'd actually been out in Scotland due to somewhere a Slovenia or somewhere like that. And it was his dad that had texted him or contacted him, all this fucking call me Tam Cowan's a day, right? But it was a headline. Now, as anybody in 29 years in newspapers experience, I know for that, not once have I ever written a headline. They get done for you to make it them eye-catching or whatever, you know. Mm-hmm. And a lot of times, even the headline isn't necessarily 100% reflective of what's in the words below, you know. So the headline, it was a headline that he'd taken issue, and I'm explaining that to him and all the rest of it. But he was a bit grumpy, shall we say. I tried to explain to him, and then I says, well, Kurt, you know what I really hate about this? I says, neither your dad nor you get in contact when you got your move for St Mirren to Rangers. Well, there were a lot of folks slagging you. I had written another column saying, give the guy a wee break. He's getting up the ladder in terms of fit, but he's doing well in his career. And it was all thing that always sticks in our throat. You'd have had St Mirren fans at the time saying, can't believe that Judas away to Rangers and all that. But he'd been trebling his money or whatever. And we always talk about any fan who's got a chance of moving to another job and getting a lot more money, you wouldn't see them for dust, you know. So I'd been talking up. And I says, I didn't see that and all, you know. So I says, well, look, there it is. We hung up the phone. I says, all the best. He was out there representing Scotland, and that was that. And I went back, and God, a lot of bother I went to that. I went back. It turns out there was three occasions I had written words to that effect in the paper, and I got the actual print copies. Didn't copy it. I got the actual print copies, and I cut out the bits, and I put them in an envelope, along with one of the producers at the time, had got me a CD of us talking about him in a clip and that very thing about going for some money to Rangers, making more money, blah, 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 and backing the guy. And I basically put it on an envelope, sent it to Kip Broadfoot, care of Rangers Football Club, Ibrox, Glasgow, and I never heard anything back. And I thought, oh, come on, if you're going to complain. Exactly, you know, so, but that's it, so, you know. But
see that offer of triple on your wages, have you ever had offers to leave off the ball and go and do something else?
Well, where would you go?
Sky?
No, where'd you go? You couldn't.
No interest in Scottish football.
Your show wouldn't work the same. It wouldn't work the same in the telly, even if it was in the telly, the BBC. There's something. There's a totally different feeling.
Oh, remember
radio
that
show.
Time in
radio
a patronising way, the BBC decided that Radio 5 Live, it must have been one of the Euros, was it? Euro?
It was a tie-in with a Euro, maybe Euro 2008. Was that a Euro year?
And they decided they would have the Welsh show, the Northern Ireland
whatever
show,
the
and the Scottish
show,
the football,
right, okay,
and
they
would go on. We went on after an England game, was it?
We went on right after an England game.
And it was 11 at night. Oof.
We put it all in
2.5 hours, and we just
played a blinder, if I say so myself.
And you know what? We were getting things like, what is this show? Where's this coming from?
Is England's actually quite a bit tame.
Oh, really, really tame. And of course, we were straight in there with Beckham and his wife jokes, and you know, that one. And I remember they were full of all those.
But you know what? We then, I even hands up, and it's something I hate doing, but even because we were aware that night, we still did it for the BBC in Glasgow, but we were broadcasting on Radio 5 Live to the whole of the UK and beyond. And I know for a fact what I didn't like about it. We didn't do it too much. We says, look, this is we'll just do this like a normal show. We're in a normal studio, so try not to be unsettled or anything. But I know for a fact, and probably for the right reasons, I kind of maybe slowed down a wee touch. Mm-hmm. I maybe tried to speak ever so clearer, the wee bit of the telephone voice coming out. Mm-hmm. So I didn't particularly like it. We got a great, great reaction to it. Yeah. But if you said, oh, would you know like doing, you know, what if, I mean, let's say like, you get Alan Brazil and Ali McCoy's not day talks, but if you said, oh, would you like to do that? I would say no, because you would need to do English football as well, you know?
Yeah.
So where we are the now with the BBC, there's no really any other show in town, you know, and sadly, and I mean that sadly, because I'm somebody that loves radio and I'm somebody that loves Scotland, the commercial radio stations, you're increasingly hearing less and less Scottish voices on it. It's just all shows that have been punted up
especially when it's music and they so put the whole kind of computer music and say, this is what we play. And you just think, well, it's not even selective. And then when they, you know, when Super Scoreboard comes on, it has to super serve Rangers and Celtic, you know, and they're not interested in St Johnson. I don't know.
Sure knows what I listen to. I can't listen to a lot of stuff. So I quite enjoy, I like Hugh Keevan's a former colleague with the Daily Reckon. I've known Hugh for years, and I help him out with his daughter's charity and that, and I know Hughie well, and I think he's the mainstay on that programme. Yeah. He's good, he knows exactly how to play it. Mm. Hughie plays a character when the he's on that. Clyde Super Scoreboard, you know. And then when you go back to the Halcyon days, which nae football fan, you're living in Scotland, you can avoid, and it was like Jimmy Sanderson that, and then Jerry McNee, the great Jerry McNee, who answered us doing as the crankies. He'd have got us in a call when we first started the show, and he was a wee bit too serious, of course, Jimmy. He said, who are these people that are appearing now, the crankies on? And I mind writing in my column at the time, and it meant it riled them up, saying about, oh, it's strange that Jerry McNeese thinking about us, one of us wearing a school uniform. whatever floats your boat, Jerry.
So a bit of backlash for Jeremy Nee, but Tam, your biggest backlash was the article you wrote on women's football.
Women's football,
what was that
yes.
like to deal with?
Well, to deal with it was great, because I made a lot of friends out of it. I did the right thing, but there's nothing to be gained by genuinely offending or upsetting them, as I almost touched on before. If somebody thinks, oh, I didn't like that column, they'll maybe no buy your paper again. Oh, didn't like that show he did, they'll flick channels and they'll tell you, oh, the radio, not a flick stations. So when I did my women's football column, the backlash, actually, if you can use that word, 99.9% of it was folk emailing in saying, why is Tam suspended after he one column about women's football? He's done loads of columns about men's football and blah, 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 taking the piss out of them for a while. But for them that did get in contact with me at the time, and the first guy was for a guy through Musselburgh way. Guy says to me, Tam, I've listened to you on that radio for years, and you take the piss out of every day, blah, blah, blah. He says, but listen, my daughter plays the football. She comes home for work on a Tuesday night. She's got to get two buses to go to training, two buses back. Doesn't even get any expenses near your slot. I says, right, whoa. I says, what's the name of your daughter's club? And he told me, and I says, right, I'll organise a wee fundraiser for a club. Went and put on a wee, like, what they'd effectively be like a sportsman's dinner kind of thing. Put it on for them, raffles, auctions, all that kind of stuff. Raised plenty of money. Didn't take a bean for it, of course. And I ended up doing that at about 13, 14 women's football clubs around the country, because at the end of the day, they're saying, oh, thanks, Tam. And I said, no, not a problem. If any of you were genuinely felt you were due an apology and you were upset and like, there we go, I'm sorry. It was only ever, anything that's ever perceived to have been something of me has got me in bother. I can say hand in heart that it always stemmed from a joke. It was never me trying to be controversial or trying to have a go at folk.
I think reflecting back on it, I mean, there were two or three things. One of the things was the timing, because I think it was a Friday column, was it?
It was a Saturday column, and yeah, the Thursday night, the women's game that night had been on both BBC television live and BBC
Correct.
Radio
yeah.
live.
But it was at the time when Life on Mars was the big TV show, had been the big TV show, and what they did was the Record, if you actually go back to it, the Record had set Tam up as the character from Life on Mars, who couldn't deal with progressive politics, couldn't deal with change, couldn't deal with women at the workplace and all of that. And
I had the jacket
on. The parody of that.
Because in one page, talking about the women's football, there's great strides they're making, right? And at the time when there was a lot of folk criticising it, well, saying it was rotten and all the rest of it, they had me done up, photoshopped this other photo, the guy from Ashes to Ashes.
Ashes to Ashes, yeah.
That was that, as if we were going back now to the 70s and Tam's writing this, you know what I mean? That was that. But I did all that stuff for the clubs, that was great. I then sponsored the Motherwell women's team. I thought, right, I better do something for my own club. And then what was great, they then get back onto me a matter of months later, and I thought, they're just at it here now, I think they're my soft touch. They says, Tam, we're really needing some new match balls for the game. Do you know anybody who, and I says, aye, right, okay, right, how much do you need? And they tell me, right, there he goes, another wee check. And then what was great, and I didn't get offended, they put, after I'd donated money to buy them new match balls, they put an advert in the Motherwell match programme on the Saturday, inside back cover, and it was brilliant. It said, come and watch the Motherwell ladies kicking Tam Cowan's balls up and down the park, right?
Yeah.
And I thought, ha, ha, ha. I thought, I'm no offended, and that's that. Yeah. And you go on, mate. But the interesting thing was, a couple of interesting
things. Well, just one wee side thing. It's quite interesting, this, that we'd been doing a lot of things for clubs and everything, and we'd gone up to a Saints game. Motherwell couldn't have been playing, or maybe Motherwell were playing St Johnstone at Perth, and we'd gone up there and we'd done a wee bit way at the area, it's called Nine Wells, the playing parks up at Perth, and we'd presented Player of the Year awards to young age group women's players. one of whom was a 9-year-old Lana Cleland, who then comes and scores that great goal for Scotland, and went to, she's at Fiorentina now in Italy. And here was this photograph of me and Tam handing the Player of the Year award to this wee girl. I mean, she was literally a wee girl at the time, 9, 10 year old. And that was long, 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 long before the controversy. Now, here's the girl at the height of the controversy, is in her early 20s and playing for Scotland. So to some extent, I think if the BBC had done something different and actually said to us, look, you actually need to go on and do a big show which is actually talking about women's football, and Stuart, you take the role of being the big ambassador and talk it up, Tam can have a wee laugh at it, it would have all kind of played away.
Bizarrely, before the ladies, the women footballers started appearing on the telly, we'd had them on for years, hadn't we?
Yeah,
we'd actively encouraged them for years. Before it was almost some box-ticking episode by, in the upper echelons of radio and television studios, and now women are right across the board, and they're constantly on the BBC and ITV, Sky, BT Sport. We actively encouraged them before. We always had the women on us, and even the one of the nice things, I remember I took a call round about the whole time of that Carry On, and it was for Maureen McGonigal, who was the former
SFA advisor, the Women's
Football Association, right? And when I knew it was her, and I thought, oh God, what's she going to say? And she says, Tam, she says, aye, we better bother on that, yep. She says, look, she says, the one thing I thought about when I read about all this is that when we launched the first ever magazine for the women's game a few years ago, you were the only male for the Scottish media that bothered to come to the wee press lunch we had. She says, so
you could slaughter them.
See, while all this was going on, did you think,
eh?
Did you think you were going to need to look for a new co-presenter? Did you think you would get the sack?
Would you know what? Here's the honest truth, and I didn't know this. I've not even told you this. We were out for our 25th year anniversary. Had a curry over in Balbiers in the West End.
Nice plug.
Love the curry, but oh, I
can do the salmon, superb.
And all the bosses that were there as well. And one of the bosses said to me over the table, he says, oh, Tam was very, very close to getting the tin tack. I mean, he said, it was just, if you hadn't gone on air and kind of just done the whole kind of thing about, you know, the mea culpas, and I think I co-presented with a woman for 2-3 weeks whilst he was suspended. But they were telling me there that he was much closer to getting the sack than I had imagined, you know, because I just thought to myself, because the real offence, if there was an offence, was published in the Daily Record. It wasn't on air. It wasn't on the BBC, you know. Yeah, yeah. So it's like a wee bit
I think
so
the
did
BBC...
Did you know that, how close you were at this
time? No, because I knew at the time on the day, it was horrible, because I remember then when it just all just caved in, and I then found myself walking out of the building at about 11:55, 5 minutes before we're due to go there, with the jacket over my shoulder and walking out with my bottom lip trembling. And it was like the end of every episode of The Incredible Hulk, when Dr. David Banner then walks away into another town for another wee adventure and all that. And I thought, oh, God almighty, you know. And then I just, so that was 2 weeks I was out. But then we'd talks with the BBC and all the time, and I thought, right, I knew the script, I'm not stupid, you know. And but I made sure that when that first day shows that I wasn't there, that they were able to have a wee dig at me, and I was saying to Stuart, right, well, mate, your official reason is that we believe Tam's staying at home to answer a lot of fan mail. Plumbing through all the emails and that, right? So that was the way to do it, and again, try to just deal with it in a jokey manner. And even when we come back, you know what, there was a lot of, you know, there was a lot of listeners who, oh, couldn't wait. Here was a chance to have a go back at Big Mouth Cowan, right? He's always taking the piss out of folk. And there was folks in and loads of gags about me, you know. And that was fine. We heard them, and that was that. You move on.
But I think one of the things that it points up, and we've kind of hinted at this a couple of times, Simon, is that the world's moved now in a direction where there's an awful lot of anxieties around about what subjects you can talk about ways that you can talk about it, what's acceptable, what isn't acceptable. And it isn't always to do just with areas like, say, for example, women's football, there was an awful lot of anxiety when Rangers imploded financially about what you could say, how you could describe it, and it started to become this whole kind of dance of the seven veils around what you were able to say, you know. Mm-hmm. And of course, if you're seeing it from the point of view of a fan of another club, you're just thinking, they're gone, they're done, you know what I mean? And all the time there's this kind of thing about, oh, don't say that and don't mention that. And this is not just in the BBC, you could see it in newspaper journalism as well. I mean, I to this day, you still get this feeling that, you know, when they do these things where they say, we asked four of our columnists to answer the following four questions, you could even say that they've balanced it there. You know, will Celtic run away with the league? You know that two of them will say yes and two will say no. You know what I mean? So there's that kind of sense of how do you impose balance into things. And our show isn't meant to be balanced. It's meant to be in praise of the Diddy teams, you know. And so, you know, if it is the case that Celtic get a doing in Europe, you're not going to not laugh at that.
And importantly, you know, Rangers' demise, would, I mean, folk used to say to me, my stock answer was, which, and I know it used to annoy some of the fans of the Diddy teams, but I was only being honest. When somebody would ask me, did you want Rangers away down there playing in league? What was the league's called at the time? It was
Division 3.
It was Division 3. And my simple answer was no. And the reason for that was, I've always said to Stuart, ideally, as a Mullow fan, the two teams I want to beat is Celtic and Rangers. They're the nights where traditionally, if I'm there with my pals, if you beat Celtic or you beat Rangers, they're the nights that you immediately go for a drink, you go for a curry. That's a Yahoo night. Yeah. No offence to brilliant clubs like Aberdeen or Dundee United or Hearts or Hibs, but when you beat them, it's a kind of a so what. So actually, if you pinned me to the wall and asked me, I would have sooner that Rangers had always been up in the top league and with us having a wee chance of getting a result. But the joy of them being out of the top league for me, Motherwell, I repeat, Motherwell managed to get into the Champions League. Not just the Champions League. Well, yeah. When the season that we were able to finish second, because it was Celtic and then AN other, right? Mm. The year we got into second, before you know it, we had Panathinaikos up at Fir Park. For a Champions League game, you know. So, and the other thing, and we always go back when MD, and I've got pals, good pals that support Rangers and that, and they say to me about that, about how, and if MD was ever taking the piss out of Rangers or that, or any club, I can always spill it back to when Motherwell went into administration in April 2002. I didn't get many sympathetic comments for Rangers fans or him or anything. It's FIPA. And I know you folk then go down the other line and say, aye, but there was a lot of folk lost their jobs because of, yep, and there was a lot of folk lost their jobs at Motherwell because of that, people that I know who lost their jobs. But you should never allow that to overlap each other when you're talking about FIPA.
Right, off the ball, future.
Future, well...
Dream guest, who's a dream guest that you still to get?
Dream guest that we still to get?
Whenever I'm asked this, I would love to get Billy Connolly on. And Billy Connolly actually does love the show whenever he gets to hear it.
Has he ever been contacted?
We used him as a trail for a while. Well, you know what? Even in the same way that even guys currently involved in football in the past, when you current players, they were always harder to get than former players. Former players maybe missed the wee bit of attention, so they like the idea of going on a radio show or doing something like that, right? Current players, if you went to Celtic or Rangers, let's say we tried to get the big boy Julian, centre-half at Celtic, right? You need to go through three layers of PR at Celtic and his agent and stuff, you know? And you'd end up just saying, no, and he's training, or he's got a game that day. You get the ex-players, it's fine. But same with Billy Connolly. Wow, Billy Connolly. Sadly, the poor man's really ill just now. He's not doing as much work as he did. But when he was in the peak of his powers, how are you meant to track down Billy Connolly for a Saturday afternoon on off the ball when he might have been out in Australia or he might have been out in Los Angeles or something? But we would love to get him on. Years ago, he did what we effectively used as a trail. He was speaking in an interview with, I think, Janice Forsyth. And when he was saying about...
Janice is interviewing him again,
about,
yeah.
Is that right? Yeah, and when she's saying things like, you know, what is it you still miss about Scotland? He says, oh, well, when I come back, and I knew to anywhere, he says, I love listening to that show with the guys on a Saturday, just talking about the football and talking in their own tongues and all that, and about, you know. So we thought, wow,
how much of a buzz is that game?
Oh, it was even a wee buzz just thinking back to now. So we used that for a long time as a wee trail for our programme, you know. Yeah. So he would be, he's not, apart from the fact that he's he does go and see Celtic when he's here. I was going to say he's not really a football guy in terms of football player, but he is a dream guest. He'd been a man for me, and if it was just a pure football name, somebody I would love to have won, it would be easy for me to mention Motherwell heroes and all that, but I do think just it'd be a fascinating guest would be Sir Alec Ferguson. Mm. I think he'd be great.
I like only watches this, so
yeah. Jazzy Jeff and the Fresh Prince.
Right.
Well, do you know what? Here's a funny story, right? Going back to my days at NME, it was the first night of a famous Raising Hell tour, Run DMC and the Beastie Boys, and they were starting their tour in Philadelphia, and the NME had said to fly over and just preview the tour. We'll get big photographs of Run DMC and the Beasties put on the cover, and you do a couple of thousand words over a double page spread, and it'll be the top-selling kind of item of the week on the NME. So I did, I flew over, and I had always this thing, it goes back to my days in the Northern Soul scene, I'm always looking for who's emergent and coming up, and the top DJs and MCs in Philadelphia at that time were Jazzy Jeff and the Fresh Prince. So anyway, I'm interviewing them in this really nice hotel in Center City in Philadelphia, and I'm chatting away, do the interview, I did a little piece on them at the end of the tour guide, the tour spread, and they're sitting down there, and my photographer, who's a guy called Lawrence Watson Law, came over to me and he says, "Oh, I'm going upstairs to watch the game," and he says, "But you're no coming because I know you want England to get beat, right?" And it was an England game, right? So I says to Jazzy Jeff and the Fresh Prince, "You want to watch this game?" And he said, "Yeah." And I says, "Well, come up my room and we'll get a beer and whatever." So Jazzy Jeff and the Fresh Prince are sitting there watching this game. We get the beers out. And of course, midway through the first half, a gentleman, you might have heard of him, Diego Armando Maradona, scored a great goal with his header, right? And the hand of God goal, I'm going, getting absolutely mad. And then of course he got the second goal. And then wondering, what the hell is going on here? Who's this guy? This guy's weird, you know? And all of that. And that was with the Fresh Prince and Jazzy Jeff.
So you're wanting to get him back on the show?
Oh, back on.
And he can tell that story.
Well, exactly.
As long as he doesn't bring his annoying fucking boy.
Exactly.
You know, you know what's his name?
He's happy. Is it Jaden or something?
I wonder how he got all the A-jobs. Oh, we are so.
Yeah, but funnily enough, Jazzy Jeff, two summers ago, Jazzy Jeff came through to play the Sub Club in Glasgow, and I was doing an interview with him for the Sub Club, and he remembered the Maradona goal.
Oh,
I said, I would never have known it was you, but you know, I remember being in the hotel room and a boy jumping over the settee when the goal went in and everything. So that's it.
Tremendous. Last question: how much longer can you see yourself doing it?
Oh, as long as we're able to get our faculties. you know, I was 50 in April. I'm still a young man. Stuart's a wee bit older than me, but got all his faculties, his joggy tops, relatively clean bill of health. And I think it'd only be, it sounds a terrible, terrible cliche, and a lot of folks say it about keep doing it as long as you're enjoying it. But to be honest with you, for us to get in on a Saturday, meet up for a wee cup of coffee in the morning, then get paid to talk shite in the radio for a few hours about the football, when we would actually be, because we would just be fans who'd be going to see our teams at every game. We'd be talking the same shite in the car or at the pub or at the stadium while watching our team. So we get to do it in a radio studio. We get to meet, you're talking about who you would really like to have on. There's been so many names that we have had on. You know, I've found that I've had a guest, I'll keep it to Mullware on the show. I've had Stevie Kirk, who was our ultimate hero for 91. We've had Willie Pettigrew, who was my biggest hero growing up, you know.
David
Clarkson. There we go. So, you know, for me to be in a position where you can enjoy that, it's kind of pinch yourself stuff, to the point that there's been many a time in the past I have still had a wee bit of the butterflies when you a certain guest or a certain face comes in.
Could it only work at 2 years? If one of you's left, would it be done?
I think it'd be difficult. Very difficult.
Folks say, I mean, whatever it is that us two have got together, folks always say it, we take our respective holidays. We used to do a lot more planning on our holidays. That was before we both had families, and we would almost try and look at the diaries and say, right, if you're going away the first 3 weeks, I'll go away the later 3 weeks, and then that means that there's always still one is there.
Yeah.
But there have been times in the last few years where we thought, well, you know,
life goes on.
You can't always dictate that, and we have had a few shows where neither of us is there. No harm to whoever's been filling in or anything.
They died a horrible death.
It's all folk that we know and all that.
Well, they died a horrible death, Dan. This is him being one of these two-faced guys. He'll tell you the truth.
No, not at all.
No, they were rotten.
I would have been delighted if they died a horrible death, because that keeps us being welcome back. But no, they went in, they did a job. But folks say to me, it doesn't sound the same without you. And then folk will say that respectively. If one of us is no there, maybe, you know, the wee bit of chemistry is no the same. So, aye, but by and large, we're always there. And even to the point, God, when I think back, the two stories, I'd already had my holidays the year that Stuart got married. So I basically imagine that I snubbed the RSVP. No. Stuart, I'm not going to you because I'll be there for the show. And that was a wee bit as well, maybe a wee bit insecure, you know, wanting to make sure Wannies was there with the show. Yeah. The other thing we did when I got married in 2005, which is on the Saturday, it was the one and only time we pre-recorded a show. Mm. Me and Stuart pre-recorded the shows on the Friday, so we could both be at the wedding on the Saturday. And that was a mixture. We didn't want our folk to do the show. Mm-hmm. And thinking back to the fees then, we didn't want to miss out on the first big one. That was back. Stuart said that when Stuart was an usher at the wedding, and Stuart said that when he welcomed everybody in, about how the fact that while the rest of you are here at a wedding spending a fortune at the bar, just because being here we're actually earning money because we pre-recorded the show. Mm-hmm. So to answer your question, I think I didn't answer anything. I would just I'd love to celebrate with the silver anniversary this year. I would love to celebrate the golden anniversary of Off the Ball. 25 years for now.
It'd be fantastic. Year? Well, do you know what? I'll be talking very much about vascular dementia at the time.
And I'll be 75. There you go. We've had guests in the show being older than 75.
Yeah, you know, the other thing about it is, I know this is really kind of daft thing to say, but I've always had a belief in life about keeping yourself young. And for me, it's young of mind rather than necessarily young in the physical age. You know, I read a lot, I watch a lot, I'm still obsessed like a child about Scottish football, and there's not an awful lot catches me out. When I'm caught out on the show, it tends to be that I've forgotten a guy that went from Morton to Port Vale or something like that. Aye. You know, it's not ever anything that really kind of catches you out. And I guess now I'm not as clued up in English football as I was when I was a kid, for the very simple reason that there's not as many Scots down there, and it doesn't really interest me. I'm not that interested.
Guys, it's been a pleasure. Thanks.
Yeah, thank you.
Thanks,
Tim. Hey, boy. Thank you very much.